with my presentation. Where you see in brackets the word revolutionaries, because I'm not sure I will have time to talk about revolutionaries, but for sure I will have time to talk about self-made women and wanderers between cultures. And what am I going to talk about? Well, I took the title of this symposium literally, and so, or better, the subtitle, because it is about tales of the visage across cultures. And so I'm going to talk about some tales, the tales that are told in some movies that I consider representative of some important cultural models over time. And these movies are La vita del chapitre Anne and the Asian Femme. And also Chiara Ferragni Unposted. If I will have time, I will talk about also Avatar and Shrek. And I took the title of the symposium literally because I'm going to talk about the different interpretations that have been given of these movies between cultures. And for cultures, I mean small cultures, the cultures of the critical viewers of these movies in Italy and in the United States. What is my goal? My goal is, as I told you before, to talk about some important cultural models we make use of to read our times. And so I position myself in a certain semiotic tradition, which goes from Roland Barthes in the mythology, in the mythologie, or Claude Lévi-Strauss in the mythologique, and in the tradition of the work that has been done by Professor Guido Ferraro, who is my mentor in the university, in his book Il linguaggio del mito, where he tried to mix together the approaches of Roland Barthes and Lévi-Strauss, because of course Lévi-Strauss talk about some cultural models of populations around the world and the way they express those cultural models in their myths, while Roland Barthes talked about our contemporary myths. And Guido Ferraro tried to mix together these ways of working on myths in his book Il linguaggio del mito, where the last chapter is about contemporary myths. But I would like to also to quote another book, Letanio Barocca of Omar Calabrese, because what I want to do is, and also again, I would like to quote Claude Lévi-Strauss and in this case, Le Cru et Le Qui, because what I would like to do is to work on some narrative matrices of our discourses on us and on how our world is. Well, what I'm looking for as Lévi-Strauss did in Le Cru et Le Qui, he demonstrated that the narrative structure of the myths told by Bororo reflected, for example, as you see in this image, the narrative structure of the society of Bororo, of not the narrative structure, the spatial structure of their villages, the way they lived, the way they conceived the world. And so Lévi-Strauss showed that, as you can see here, there are some modal semiotic systems that we use to make a lot of discourses about the world we live in, different discourses that take shape with different codes of with different codes, like for example, the verbal one, if we tell stories verbally, or the audiovisual one, if we tell stories with movies, or also with the codes of how we give shape to the space. And Omar Calabrese did something similar in his book, L'Eternio Barocca, when he showed that there are these semiotic amodal systems that are made of, how can we say, oppositions between some concepts that we use many times in television, cinema, newspapers, in factual and fictional discourses to say something about the world we live in. But Omar Calabrese did it with contemporary culture and pop culture, which is what I would like to do with my analysis. Why do I work on La Vida d'Elle, Chapitre, Anne and Deux, and Jeune Femme together? Because in my opinion, they are different movies, but they tell the same message about who we are, how our world is. And it is easy to understand it also if we look at the critical reviews of these movies, which say more or less the same. For example, here I quote some of them from Italy, where they say exaggerating Flaubert Adèle Senoux, it's about La Vie d'Adèle, since this young woman represents the underlying problem of the solitude of the contemporary individual, of the misery of the proposals for liberation and full and profound self-affirmation that this era makes available. And for what concerns Paola, the heroine of Jeune Femme, other film critics in Italy have argued that she's really one of the more authentic female characters of recent years, as she symbolizes the cry of the new generations who want to reclaim their place in the world. And she's a matrix, which is very interesting if told by a non-semiotician, on which one could place a face extracted at random from the lot of contemporary European youth. So for the Italian critics, La Vida d'Elle and Jeune Femme tell something about us and also about our faces, the faces of young people of today. As you can see, I showed it to you before, but you can see it also here. The face is very important in these movies since the beginning, because the movie posters are based on the faces of their protagonists. And all the Italian critics talk about the importance, the meaning that those faces have to tell the overall meaning of these movies. But before talking about the faces of the protagonists, let me talk about the narrative structure of these stories, and then we go to the faces. Well, first of all, let me tell you that these stories are about the identity of these characters, because of course they talk about young girls that look for themselves from try to understand who they are and look for themselves in our nowadays society. And they want to be free. They don't want to have any prejudice about who to be. In fact, in both of the movies, they look for love with with men and women. So bisexual and homosexual relationships. They look for themselves in the upper class society. They try to settle there, but they also try to settle in the lower class society because they don't have prejudices and they just want to be free to find themselves. They have, using a category which is important to my discourse, which is the opposition between a perspective instance and a sending instance, that are the two pillars on which the narrative structure of a story is constructed, to the theories of Guido Ferrara expressed in Teoria della Narrazione and also in Semiotica 3.0 in many of his books. The perspective instance is the instance that tells the story from the point of view of the protagonist and from the point of view of his values. And the sending instance is the perspective of the sender, using also Gray-Masian terms. And so the values of the sender and the point of view of the sender. And many times, in a particular kind of stories, which is the kind of stories La vita d'elle and Jeune Femme Belong to, this relationship between the perspective instance and the sending instance, that are carriers of values that tell how the world must be seen, tells also about the identity of the characters, because in the difference or in the relationship between the values and the vision of the world of the characters that carry the perspective instance or carry the sending instance, we can tell who they are. And if we read the Italian critics of La vita d'elle, for example, we read that this movie is about a wanderer. Who is a wanderer? A wanderer is someone who looks for herself with total freedom, but never finds a place in the niches of our society that work following the values of many sending instances that are present in our society. For example, the sending instance of the upper class society, or the sending instance of the lower class society. These characters always find a sort of a barrier that you can see here in the horizontal line that I draw in this graph. They try to move towards the niche of society in which all the people they meet live, but they are never able to settle there, because in all the niches of society there's a sort of an alienation they find. Because, for example, in the upper class society they find individualist people that look for their self-fulfillment and for what they want to achieve, but these takes them to alienate themselves from the others, while in the lower classes of their society there are people who try to make ends meet, and of course they go towards alienation from themselves. And so these youngsters end up wandering, and for example, La vita d'elle finishes with the protagonist wandering because she hasn't found what she looked for, and she was in love with a representative of the upper class society, an artist, while she came from the lower class society. And in fact, as you can see, some critics of this movie say these girls believe that existence comes before essence, that is, experience is not made comprehensible by a previous definition of the self, but on the contrary, subjectivity is determined by the multiplicity of experiences themselves. And yet, despite this attempt not to be defined a priori by the rules of society, Adele ends up, for several critics, with experimenting, as I told you before, the misery of the proposals for liberation and full and profound self-assertion that this era makes available, as is always the case in cliché cinema, all centered on social classes as regulators of an order that is difficult to negotiate, and on the tranche de vie never understood as mere section of everyday life, but rather as emblematic segments of learning paths that do not produce evolutions. These characters never evolve themselves because they never find a place in the world. This is the same in Jeune Femme, which again is criticized by film critic reviewers in Italy as a movie about a generation that no longer identifies itself with the bourgeois ideals and aspiration of the second half of the 20th century. Yet it is, they are too weak to propose an alternative model. Someone directly talk about wandering and the flânerie, because Jeune Femme is written like a movie of the French Nouvelle Vague, but they also find out that it seems like a movie of the French Nouvelle Vague, because the protagonist is again a young girl who doesn't know what she wants. She only wants to be accepted by society, to find a place in the world, but she tries to find it in all the niches of the society I told you before. So she wanders, but she never finds a place, even if she would like to find it, because the critic who talks about the flânerie of the Nouvelle Vague says, it's written like a Nouvelle Vague film, but this flânerie is meant to rejoin a place in the society and not to look yourself in the society like it was in the 60s and the 70s, well, when the Nouvelle Vague movies were made. And let me talk about the signs of wandering, because if you look at the faces of the protagonists of these movies, these faces are portrayed as a sort of a mixture of signs, the signs of, I've called them the signs of wandering, which are, for example, the signs of sensation, movement, separation, and incompleteness. What do I mean for this? Let me tell you, before showing you the faces of the protagonists with some shots of the movies, that these signs, in a way, symbolically represent the narrative structure that I've told you before, no? Because you move from your perspective instance towards ascending instance, and you try to find with sensations if it makes sense to move in this sense. And of course, the signs of movement are very important. You see here the arrows that symbolize, no, this movement in my way of portraying the narrative structure of this movie. And also the separation, no, the separation that I drew with an horizontal line. Now I will show you how it is portrayed in the representation of the faces of the protagonists of these movies. And of course, incompleteness, as you read before, also the stories are incomplete, because also in Jeune Femme, for example, the protagonist ends up walking on the street because she doesn't find a place in the world. It seems that she found it because she falls in love with a colleague of hers, but then she decides to have an abortion of the baby that they had together, because she doesn't believe she can live in such a niche of the society. And so also her story is incomplete. And what do I mean with signs of sensation and movement, separation, and completeness? For example, in La Ville d'Adèle, everybody, every critic says that the mouth of Adèle is very important, because she tastes life, no? And a lot of words have been spent to talk about the reason why the movie director Abdel Latif Kechiche shoots Adèle so closely and always focusing on her mouth. And she always tastes many things in the movie, because what she tastes is the sending instance of the niche of the society in which she wants to go. She tastes life. And there are many signs of sensation in that movie, not only the mouth of Adèle, but also, for example, many close-ups of the skins of the protagonist of this film. And this is the same in Jeune Femme, where you can also see the face of the protagonist, Paula, wounded, no? Because her skin is wounded from eating metaphorically the sending instances of the niches of the society that she tries to enter. And all the time in the movie, her face is shooting very closely again, also because of her eyes, which are, of course, a part of the face which deals with sensation. And you can see that her eyes are of two different colors, which is a choice of the movie director because Letizia Dosch, which is the actress who plays the role of Paula, doesn't have eyes of different colors in real life. But in the movie director wanted to show also from the different colors of the eyes of the protagonist that she tries to settle in different sending instances of the word, which have very different meanings, but she doesn't find a place because she remains incomplete. And with movement, I mean that these movies are shooted with the handheld camera that makes you also feel the movement of the perspective instance towards, not the sending instance of these movies. And as I told you before, the two movies end up with the characters walking, so moving around the towns, but they walk all the time around their times, trying to find a place that they don't find. And what do I mean with separation? It's very important in both movies that the close-ups and of the protagonists divide them from the background. So we see them, we see the particulars of their faces. And as you can see, for example, here in this shooting of La Vida d'Elle, we lose the vision of the background in which they live. Or when we see the background, we see that, like in La Vida d'Elle, there they don't settle, they are alone. No? For example, this is the end of the movie where she understands that she cannot live in the sending instance of her lover of the upper bourgeois class. And this is also here in Jeune Femme, where you can see the protagonist separated from the world and the sending instances of the world in which she tries to find a place. And for what concerns incompleteness, well, for example, La Vida d'Elle quotes La Vie de Marianne, which is a Marivaux novel, which is incomplete, never ended, like in the title of the movie, Chapitre, La Vida d'Elle, Chapitre un and deux, meaning that there will be a third or a fourth chapter, but it is not in the movie because the movie is incomplete. And the incompleteness of Jeune Femme is something I have already told you before. So let me tell you a theoretical idea about what the faces, the particular faces of the protagonists of these movies mean. Well, their particular faces are formants of a modal science and narrative structures that may take other forms in other narratives and also in our everyday lives, as you may remember, tell some film critics of these movies who say, well, the faces of the protagonists of this movie remind the faces of all of us. So, because our faces can also be, if seen with the cultural models and the narrative structures of a discourse that I am describing here in my speech, may be seen as formants of the science that give the word the meaning that I'm talking about here. So here I'm quoting Grimas and Cortese and what they say in their dictionary about what a formant is. A formant is a an element of the chain of the plane of expression corresponding to a unit of the content plane, and in this case the unit of the content plane is a narrative structure, and at the moment of semiosis allows the sign to constitute, allows the plane of expression to constitute in itself as a sign. And here I quote another novel, which is very important in Italy because it won the Premio Strega, which talks about some other formants of this narrative structure and these signs of wandering, as I told you before, which is the Otto Montagne. As I told you, it won the Premio Strega, so it was very much sold in Italy and very much appreciated by many people. Also, for example, in my ward, because I used to go to the mountains and to climb in the mountains, and my friends, my climber friends tell me, ah, well, I read the Otto Montagne, it is exactly about how life is. And what's the Otto Montagne? What's the story of the Otto Montagne? Imagine that instead of descending instance 1, 2, and n, there are 8 sending instances, the 8 mountains. And this story is about a guy, a young guy, who looks for his place in the world with his perspective instance. He wants to be free. He moves from a mountain to another, and he never finds his place in the world. And the guys who tries to look themselves, to find their place in the world only in one mountain, in, for example, in descending instance 1, end up very badly if you read this book, because they haven't understood that the world is not like this, finding a place, a singular place in one singular niche in the world that works with the values of descending instance of the traditions of the mountains. And this guy, Paolo Cognetti, writes books like Senza mai arrivare in cima, which means never arriving to the top. And the people who like the mountains, which were the place in which you had a goal, you wanted to achieve it, and you wanted to arrive in the top, now have to enjoy staying in the mountains, wandering like wanderers without ever arriving to the top, but only moving, feeling the sensations that you can feel in the mountains, knowing that you always will be incomplete and knowing that you always will be separated from the place in which you stay, because you have to move, you never settle, no? But let me tell you one more thing. Well, a cultural model, a narrative structure is like science, no? It makes sense for difference if we follow the structuralist epistemology, no? Told us by Ferdinand de Saussure. So a sign, like for example a letter T, is a letter T because it's different from a letter L or from another letter. And so also a narrative structure meaningful because it is different from another narrative structure that is also part of our society or of our culture. And so this is the reason why I decided to work on Chiara Ferragni Unposted, because Chiara Ferragni Unposted is clearly the movie that uses the opposite narrative structure to the one that I showed you before about the wandering, no? Because it's about a woman, a self-made woman that finds herself a place in our world, who has a perspective instance based on values that are absolutely the same as the values of the sending instance of a certain part of the society in which she wants to settle, and she settles because she succeeds. And if you watch this movie and you find out how the face of the protagonist of this movie is portrayed, and as you can see here, once again in the poster, the face of the protagonist is very, very important to tell the meaning of this story. Well, you see that the signs that symbolically represent the narrative structure that I show you here, and the reason why you see the morphology of the folk tale of prop and the historical roots of the wonder tale of prop here in this slide, it's because, as you may all know, this is also the narrative structure of the stories studied by prop, no? Of people trying to find a place in the society they belong to, going maybe away from there and then going back and marrying the princess, not the wife of the king, who is the representative of the sending instance in which the protagonist wants to settle. And well, if you watch Chiara Ferragni Unposted, you see that the signs used to portray her face, and not only her face, are signs of vision, steadiness, integration, and completeness. Of course, the symbol of the story of Chiara Ferragni is this image of her walking in front of Dolce & Gabbana and being totally integrated with the world of fashion in which she wants to live, or for example, her face in the reviews of fashion. But you will see that, for example, she founded a society called Chiara Ferragni, whose symbol is the eye, no? The eye of Chiara, because Chiara has a good eye to distinguish what's beautiful and what's not, what's fashionable and what's not. And if you see the way the camera is used in those movies, it's used to emphasize the steadiness of Chiara in following her dream. And you will see Chiara very integrated with a lot of people, like all the famous people belonging to the world of fashion and to the world of influencers. And the movie ends up with her crying because she says, "I feel complete. I am a mother. I got married with the prince, the singer Fedez. Now we have a baby, and I am a businesswoman, and I influence everybody." So she cries and she says, "I couldn't feel more complete." But now let's go to the interpretations of.
Ecco, Antonio, scusami se ti interrompo, se vogliamo avere, diciamo, 7-8 minuti di discussione dovremmo concludere, perché all'una dovremmo lasciare la Zoom room.
Ok, but I am very, very close to the conclusions, because what I want to tell you is that if you read the film critics of Chiara Ferragni Unposted, most of them in Italy will tell you what you can read here, that this story, even if it talks about a true woman and a true story, is somehow fake, because it's the story that everybody likes to hear, because it's about a young girl that found her place in our world. But as they say, it's dangerous because it creates illusions, because Chiara Ferragni is not a real self-made woman, because she didn't do everything on her own, but with the help of a lot of things that I don't have time to quote. But anyway, what's important is that in Italy, most of the Italian critics believe that this story is fake. And this impresses me also because I have many students that ask me to do the thesis on the world of influencers, because they strongly believe that this story is true and can also be their stories. While, as you can imagine, in the United States, if you read the interpretations of this movie, nobody argues that this story is fake. They all believe it's a very important story of our time because it's about a self-made woman, etc. And when they criticize it, they say, "Well, we criticize it because it doesn't talk about the impact of fashion on climate or things that are not important for the Italian critics." And this is also the same if we read the American critics of La Vida Dell, for example, because nobody underlines this problem of wandering, because they believe that this is only a movie about how sex and love can unite very different people, and it doesn't matter if they split at the end, because it only tells about sex and love, or maybe they are about gender issues, like the way an homosexual relationship has been shooted by a man, because the movie director of this movie is a man. But they don't talk about this, because it seems like this vision of the world that I told you before about the wandering narrative structure is something that that is meaningful only in the culture of the Italian critics and not abroad. Thank you very much.